Hey guys, gals, and non-binary pals. Today we're going to talk about the most infamous species of amphibian in the world. And that is the cane toad, or the marine toad, or neotropical toad. Everything has different names, but we all know about the cane toad, right? So that's what the species spotlight is on today. This is our cane toad, or marine toad as I like to call them. So these guys are, as I just stated, the world's most famous amphibian, and they're one of the largest species of toad. I think they're like the third or fourth largest species of toad frog in the world. Like the Goliath bull frogs from Africa are a little bit bigger, but these guys can get pretty big. So we'll start just talking off a little bit about these guys. So as I said, they get pretty big. So they usually, you know, are around 5 to 6 inches. I'm going to try not to move too much because he does not like being handled, and there's good reasons as to why I don't handle him, and I'll get to that in a second. So, you know, 4, 5, 6 inches, but they can get even larger. So females are usually a little bit longer, and that's to accommodate for, like, the large sizes of eggs and things like that. But they can reach upwards of 9.5 to 10 inches long. So huge little frogs. This guy's probably about 5.5 inch from head to butt. I know, I'm sorry, little one. I know, he really does not like being out, and he really hates the bright lights. So I'm going to do this as easy and less stress as possible. Originally, they're from Central and South America, so their range is actually all the way up into like the southern little bit of Texas, where they do occur naturally in Texas, all the way down through Central America, all the way down into kind of northern Central South America. That's where they're originally from. And they are normally found in kind of like open grasslands and woodlands that, you know, in a lot of those areas, there are seasonal changes of weather, like high rainy seasons and things like that. But they have found, as the years go on, because we've known about these guys for a long time, they actually prefer man-made environments. So drainage ditches, cauldrons, alleys, places like that. Because that's where a lot of pests preside, and so where bugs and small rodents and critters like that appear, so does the cane toad. And earlier when I said that we've known about them for a long time, I mean a long time. There have been fossils found from the early to mid Miocene, so like, think saber-toothed tiger, right? Entirely the same, indistinguishable, can't tell the difference between that fossil toad and this guy. So they've been around for a while, and we've known about their environmental pest control things for a very long time too, and that's exactly why they've become so famous as, you know, essentially the world's best and most well-known introduced species that has become invasive around the world. These guys have accidentally become invasive in a couple places, but most of the places outside of their historic range, they're there because we put them there. So obviously they're most famous in Australia, and I'll talk about the Australia problem in just a little while. But these guys have been introduced to different places from the 1800s into the 1950s, starting with, and just to name a few, the Philippines, Jamaica, French Guiana, Hawaii, Florida, islands of Japan, a lot, Barbados, so many different places, and there's a lot more. The list is like 40 places long. It's insane that we deliberately try to put them in. We actually once tried to introduce them into Louisiana unsuccessfully. I don't know how that happened, but unsuccessfully in Louisiana. But that's where this guy is actually from, is Florida. This is a field-collected invasive from Florida that someone purchased from a reptile distributor in Florida and then was given to me by him. So that's where this guy's from. So hooray, out of South Florida. So as I said before, in Australia, these guys are most famous because of Australia, where they have taken over so much of that entire continent. And the main reason why is because they grow fast. They breed fast, young and big, and they don't have a whole lot of natural predators. So with all true toads, so the bufo, although these guys aren't actually bufo, they have these large glands right at the back of their head, on the top of their heads, that are enlarged that contain contain a secretion of a poisonous toxin or bufotoxins. And in high concentrations, you know, from a medium to large size cane toad, that can be toxic for a lot of animals, including people. Like, if I sat there and put him in my mouth and started to chomp down, that may not end well for either of us. And so because of that, animals have started to avoid them entirely. So they don't have, and that includes a lot of different venomous reptiles, dingoes, Tasmanian tigers, because they're in Tasmania too, quolls, a lot of animals won't touch them because they are so highly toxic. That being said, there is one species of snake that is capable of eating them in Australia. It's a type of keelback. It's actually in the same genus as the only poisonous snake, the tiger keelback, in Indonesia, but that's neither here nor there. So they're a big problem because, well, kind of people, like everything else, you know, it's always, they're there. They're not there because they wanted to be there. They're there because we put them there. But that being said, these guys are actually a really interesting species outside of the whole, you know, destroying the ecosystem and all of that really bad jazz. That being said, they are really good bug eaters because they're a toad. And if any of you out there keep frogs or toads, you know that they are great eaters and they will eat anything that they think they can get their hands or mouth onto. Sometimes they can get a little overzealous with those things. That's why they were introduced everywhere, because they are great natural pesticides. But in their natural range down in South America, a lot of indigenous tribes of South America and Central America would use those bufotoxins in a similar way as the poison dart frogs, or they'd use it as an arrowhead poison, which is really cool. Since then, we've started to use them for a lot of other things. So for in a lot of kind of, you know, the Asian, old, kind of, that kind of medicine, I don't want to sound too derogatory or too negative in any way like that, but essentially in a lot of Asian cultures, they've been using them for an aphrodisiac, they've used it as a hair replacer or a hair tonic, they've used it as a stimulant for, well, both for the aphrodisiac part as well as hair stimulations for just overall health. They've used it in cardiovascular surgery to lower patients' heart rates while working on that. They've also been widely adapted and used for laboratory work because they don't take up a whole lot of room. They can be studied for the bufotoxins, which can be used in a lot of things, like we said, talked about, like with the lowering blood pressure and heart rates and things like that. They do make interesting pets. And I know that sounds really bad to say, as I just spent the last 5 minutes telling you how toxic they are and why they're taking over everywhere, but if you're wearing gloves, if you're handling them, if you're carefully, and if you're washing your hands regularly, although I still would not recommend really any sort of regular handling of any amphibian, even toads, which, you know, can adapt a little bit drier climates, which is why they're warty, why they're drier, I still wouldn't do it. And they do clean themselves so that you can actually get the bufotoxins on the rest of their actual skin too, because they'll sit there and rub their legs across those glands too, so it can be kind of all over them. But they actually make kind of interesting pets. They will recognize people. They will come up to the front of their enclosures to ask for food. You can kind of feed them whatever. They're trash cans, so they can be fed a wide variety of foods. Any real insect you can give them to. You can give them fish. You can give them, well, I don't really recommend it, you could give them smaller amphibians, rodents, things like that. Not with any sort of regularity, mind you, but they can kind of take whatever, and they get a decent size. You can see them, you know, I'll give him a little bit more room. Obviously, this is not what he lives in. He's actually in an enclosure that's a little bit longer than this whole table and about as wide, but this is just for the show off because I'm not going to mess with him too much. But that being said, cane toads, they are a really interesting animal. And yeah, there's a whole lot of negativity associated with them, and rightly so. They are very bad invasive, but once again, it's not their fault they're invasive. It's kind of entirely our fault why they're there and why they're invasive in the first place. But with that in mind, if you do decide to keep one as a pet, just make sure you wash your hands well, give them plenty of space, give them lots of food, clean water, all that jazz. And they can be a really cool and interesting oddball pet that maybe not a whole lot of people have, but is still pretty cool. Hope you enjoyed this video. If you have any questions about marine toads or anything else, please let me know down in the comments. Please check out our podcast, Keep Calm, It's Just a Snake Podcast. No, it's not just about snakes. That's just what I could come up with it. I've been asked that question several times. It's not. I've had plenty of different people on there, and hopefully we'll have a wide variety in the future. But once again, hope you enjoyed the video. Please check out the podcast. Check us out on Instagram, Facebook. If you want to help support what we're doing here, hit me up on Patreon. There's some really cool rewards, as well as you get to see some behind the scenes things about stuff that I haven't shown on video, new animals coming in, new ideas about where we're going to be going on reptile adventures and things like that. So, thank you again. Thank you for your time. Hope you're having a great day, and we'll check you next time.